ago, I traveled to Tulsa, Oklahoma from Lawrence, Kansas to attend the ordination of a promising new minister. Over the course of that weekend, I was wrong about little things many times. What time events started, where things were located, and so on. And what was uncommon, I think, was not that I was wrong, but that my errors were pointed out to me. And I went through something like stages of grief, trying to accept this. Shock, denial. Actually, I just stayed with shock and denial until the final day of our trip, when I wanted to take the interstate back to Lawrence. The road that we had traveled down to Tulsa was two lanes. It was summer, there was construction, there was not much of a shoulder, and there had been the occasional truck overhanging the center line. I tend to get a little carsick. Also, I'm a bit of a control freak. In short, the interstate just sounded like an excellent idea, and my fellow passengers agreed, in theory. But they voiced a concern. It did not look like there actually was an interstate option between Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Lawrence, Kansas. And there is not. Not unless you want to go 150 miles out of your way, which is precisely what we did because I told us to. The map and time and basic common sense were not on my side, but I spoke with that potent combination of ignorance and hubris so common in people who have no idea what they're talking about. It can be very persuasive. That path home was so far out of the way that our driver's GPS simply refused to calculate the time or distance of our chosen route, which is how it came to be at a rest area somewhere north of Oklahoma City. I finally did some basic math and said conversationally, "It turns out I was wrong." After 90 minutes in the car, we still had 4 hours left of a 3-hour route. The atmosphere in the car after that was thick with unspoken recriminations and silence. And by the time anyone spoke to me again, I had composed most of this sermon in my head. Since rewritten, I have many, many opportunities to think about being wrong. In learning about this uncomfortable, embarrassing, so very human phenomenon, I discovered some things that helped me to understand how my own brain works. And I think also a little bit more about our shared project as religious liberals. It turns out, and this is not news to any of the people who are traveling with me this summer, it turns out that I am indeed wrong a lot. In fact, it turns out that we all are. Even at these times, though, we often think we are right. In fact, we may consistently overestimate our performance, our accuracy, even our goodness. There is an entire branch of cognitive science devoted to this concept, which is called illusory superiority. Illusory superiority is simply the delusion that we are better at something than we actually are. If you remember that study that showed that the vast majority of Americans believe that they are above average drivers, it's a great example. That study really happened. It turns out that similar forces are at work anytime we consider what we know. And there are several interesting things about this. First, by and large, we Americans, and I'm being specific about that because this effect varies by culture, we Americans think we are better at everything than we are. And our ability to actually gauge our own performance accurately, it declines the farther away from average, from a basic level of performance competence that we get. And on the other hand, those with skills in the top 10% of a skill set, those experts, they tend to underestimate their performance. One theory about this is that when a skill seems easy for us, we wrongly assume that it's equally easy for others. Regardless, the more clueless we are, the less we seem to know it. And if we have things nearly figured out, we will remain forever aware that there is yet more to know. If this sounds vaguely familiar, it may be because similar concepts have been voiced in philosophy and in religion for millennia. Real knowledge is to know the extent of one's ignorance. That's Confucius. Bertrand Russell stated that one of the painful things about our time is that those who feel certainty are stupid. And those with any imagination and understanding are filled with doubt and indecision. Shakespeare opined in As You Like It that the fool doth think he is wise, but the wise man knows himself to be a fool. If that is true, I am perhaps on my way to wisdom at last. What is needed to counter my own inclination to overestimate my abilities, my knowledge, my strength, is some perspective. And this too has been borne out by science. The tendency of truly incompetent people to overestimate their skill level goes away once those individuals receive some basic training in a skill area. The training does little to improve the participants' actual skills. Skill development takes time, practice, and in some areas, think tennis or chess, it requires a measure of innate talent. But schooling, focused, targeted schooling, helps because it provides perspective. What we learn from this is that it is difficult to reach mastery, but it's possible to inspire humility. And that humility is important. In an average year, 37 infants and toddlers die in a summer after being accidentally left in hot cars. These deaths are horrifying, they're tragic, they are needless at a very basic level. And they are also so easy to condemn until you look closer at the individual stories and at the science that has been done trying to prevent this phenomenon. For most families struck by this tragedy, there are three risk factors that have been found to stand out, and they are all so very understandable. The first is parental exhaustion, that shambling dark night of the soul that happens when you are parenting an infant or a toddler or a young preschooler. The second is a sudden change in daily routine. You are taken off your path. You are doing something different. It doesn't have to be important, just different. And the third thing. The third risk factor is a belief good parents do, resulting in a lack of awareness of risk and no safety plan. About 37 children a year die this way, but there are hundreds, maybe thousands, more close calls. And sometimes the difference between those two things is more than luck. It's taking risk seriously. Parents and caregivers who work together, knowing that communication and checking in might be all that prevents a tragedy. People who realize in time that something is wrong because we know that we are capable of making this serious of a mistake. Good parents make mistakes all the time, and illusory superiority can kill. When it counts, we must know that we can be wrong, that we too make mistakes, and often. Fortunately, there is another interesting thing about illusory superiority. Something I haven't told you yet, nearly all of us are reliably good at gauging the performance of those we know. I may not accurately predict my own performance, but if we know one another well, I can predict yours. This holds true whether we're talking about performance on a logic test or projecting a good friend's contribution to a pledge drive. When we think about others, we assess not by how we wish to see them, but by what we know. So can we begin to look at ourselves this way? It turns out the answer is no. At least in the absence of major depression, viewing ourselves through rose-colored glasses is mentally protective. The process has to do with dopamine receptors and communication between the area of the brain that governs the sense of self and reward and the heart that assesses performance. But that friend or boss or colleague who gives you feedback that you did not want to hear, that person willing to risk your relationship to share an honest assessment, that person, statistically speaking, is right. Not about themselves, they are happily fooling themselves too. They're right about you. To move with humility, seek critical feedback from people who know you, and listen to it. I have been trying to convince you with science what religion has known for a very long time, that we humans mess up predictably, reliably, certainly. We can throw the word sin out of our vocabularies, but we cannot escape this fundamental reality of living together, of living with ourselves. Christianity explains this with the doctrine of original sin. Adam and Eve made that first mistake with that tempting apple in the garden, and it was all downhill from there. Unitarian Universalist humanist theologian Anthony Pinn, on the other hand, suggests that our errors, while guaranteed, are a combination of our biology and our acculturation, that both are products of evolution, of process, and that both our biology and our culture support and limit our ability to function to our highest potential. Some of you may be familiar with the work of the Reverend Nadia Bowles Weber. She is the motorcycle-driving, social justice-loving, thoroughly tattooed minister in the Liberal Lutheran Church out in Denver. She's an ELCA pastor. She founded the House for All Sinners and Saints, but I'm talking to you about her this morning because before all of this, she tried merciless. In Bulls Weber's words, Unitarians are such smart, good people. They seem so hopeful. I wanted to be one of them badly, but I couldn't pull it off. 4 years of sobriety didn't come to me as a result of hopefulness or exclusively positive thinking. It was grace. She goes on to explain that in her experience of human nature, in her experience of herself, in fact, as a drunk and as an addict, people reliably screw up, and any meaningful theology to get us through our days, our weeks, our years, has to acknowledge this. Nadia Bulls-Weber speaks of her need for something more, for her that is a higher power, there to call us out, bring us up short, accept our reflections and retractions and our wishes to do better. Regret is a powerful emotion and one that we may, as a people, understand to be dangerous. But I am before you this morning to say that we Unitarian Universalists need something that calls us back to our better selves, to our highest aspirations also. It's just that on our best days, we already have it. I'm not talking about divine authority, though you may find it to be meaningful in your life. As a faith shaped by how we agree to be with one another, the deeper calling is out of ourselves and to each other. Our higher power is a real, accountable, covenantal community. And I wonder if part of what is needed for this movement, for our denomination, for progressive faith to reach its potential in this hurting, needing world, in this oh-so-urgent moment, is acknowledging that so often we don't. Admitting to ourselves and to one another that we build community, this community, imperfectly, every day. That we screw up and act selfishly and we break our vows 1,000 times. And that our faith calls us to come yet again into the spaces that we have built. That our faith calls us and calls one another back, asking that we move together forward, inviting us to build bridges by living more fully into the spaces between us. As Unitarian Universalists, we reject the message that we are bad people, but our work together can only find traction by embracing the truth that we all do bad things. We do this as we move toward each other instead of backing away even when we've been hurt. We do this when we use our pain as a signal, understanding that pain asks us, above all, to listen. To listen to ourselves, to listen to one another. And we move toward the holy also when we offer sincere apology for our mistakes. We don't have a group ritual of repentance, at least not one we practice with any regularity. Muscles are built through regular practice. But my people, we have words that can help. And saying those words of apology where they are needed is to situate ourselves on the side of love with great courage. I am sorry. I ask your forgiveness. I know that I hurt you, and if you'd like to talk, I am here to listen. Part of the theology of our UU communities is that not one of us is set apart, no one untouched by blessings or exempt from obligations. Even myself, as a lowly seminarian, finding myself that day on the outskirts of Oklahoma City when I meant to be nearer to Lawrence, Kansas. I messed up on that day. It was a small thing in the long run. It would have been forgotten years ago if I didn't keep telling this story. But it was an opportunity to explore with a group of people a new way of being. As I was called by members of my community and then from deep within myself to recognize the limits of my knowledge and to accept the need for repentance and grace, which I entered into with relief the moment I sincerely apologized. I forgive you, my elder companion said. And you know, I realized that I messed up too. We should have known better than to listen to you. It's a gift, humility. Amen. I invite you to rise.